morning, Lafayette Avenue Presbyterian Church. And for all those who are watching this morning, this is Sunday, August 8th. We're happy that you are here with us. We have a summer soul hangout. Miss Heather is teaching an outdoor Sunday school on Monday evenings at 5 p.m. from June through September. If you have any questions, please contact Heather at heather@elmwoodjesus.org. The blessing box does not take a summer vacation, and we are in dire need of some essentials for the blessing box, so if you could drop them off at church, it would be greatly appreciated. Don't forget that we're having a joint worship service next Sunday at First Church at Symphony Circle, and they will join Lafayette on Sunday, August 29th. So next Sunday, do not come to Lafayette Avenue Presbyterian Church at the corner of Lafayette and Elmwood. Go to the First Church at Symphony Circle. I am sure that they will also have a Zoom or an online service, and maybe Patty will put that in the weekly email so that we know how we can watch for those who are home. So again, welcome to Sunday, August 8th. We're happy that you are here.
And again, good morning. I'm Gladys Gifford, and I'm glad to be back here helping out with the service at Lafayette Avenue. Please join me in the call to worship. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together.
Souls, the sorrow.
Good morning. We are reading Isaiah 55, 1 through 13. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest affair. Give ear and come to me, listen that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of the peoples. Surely you will summon nations who know not, and nations who do not know will coming to you, come running to you. Because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has endowed you with splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will grow the juniper, and instead of briars the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign that will endure forever.
It's such a great joy to hear that passage from Isaiah, isn't it? There's so many familiar phrases in it. And now let's turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 6. Jesus and the crowds are talking about bread. John chapter 6, starting at verse 25. When they, the crowd, found him, Jesus, on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them, Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. And then skipping down to verse 48. Jesus speaking says, I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, and so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for this life of the world is my flesh. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. I used to bake bread years ago, and I remember when the smell of yeast filled the house, and that first slice of moist, freshly baked bread satisfied the mouth and quieted the hunger that was building all day. Melt a patty of real butter into that slice, and heaven is at your fingertips. Real bread. These days, my husband and I enjoy fresh bread offered at the market by the Mennonites. When I cut slices from that beautiful loaf of multi-grain bread, our ordinary ham and cheese sandwiches turn into a hearty meal. Real bread. Real nourishment. How far would you and I go for free bread? The crowd in today's gospel went across a whole lake. They were not satisfied with just one emergency meal from Jesus. They camped out on the hillside that night, keeping an eye on Jesus and his disciples. But when the disciples gave them a slip in the boat, the crowd rented the next boats that came by and followed the disciples across the lake, looking for Jesus to do it again. They labeled Jesus as the new provider of emergency bread, of manna. So they spent their money for transportation, figuring that all they had to do was to show up. They were content to settle for manna, not real bread. Manna, the emergency bread, the emergency nourishment for a wilderness life, not real bread. Jesus saw through their scam. He was annoyed. He had fed those people yesterday, all 5,000 of them, and there was so much food, there were even leftovers. They stuffed themselves. But they were greedy. They chased after him, not because they were in dire need. After all, they could afford to hire boats. Rather, they saw a terrific bargain, a source of cheap bread, free for the asking, and they wanted to stockpile more for themselves. Jesus rebuffed them. He recognized their greed. He said, "You gorged yourselves on free bread yesterday, and now you want more?" "Yeah, yeah," they said, "give us more. More miracles, more manna, more bread." We remember the story about manna in Exodus chapter 16. Manna, the miraculous, what is it, stuff, remained on the ground in the morning after the dew dried up. Manna was a strange material, flaky like cereal, that only lasted for a few hours until the sun grew too hot. People gathered it in baskets, enough for one day's use. Gather too much, and the manna would rot. But on Friday morning, they were to gather enough for 2 days' use so that they could observe the Sabbath correctly. This miracle of emergency food went on for 40 years, according to Scripture. I can't imagine how the women of ancient Israel dealt with such strange food. Sweet, gummy material, only good for boiling, useless for baking. Such stuff might do for a snack now and then, but every day? They had no choice but to use it. The wilderness wanderings did not give them time to raise wheat. There were no markets out in the desert where they could buy supplies, and so they cooked. But you can be sure that they were delighted when they left the wilderness and it could again bake real bread. No more manna. Jesus' challenge was this: do you want manna or real bread? With Isaiah, he called out, "Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen, so you may live. The crowd heard Jesus and called out, Sir, give us this bread always. The crowd was hungry. They wanted real bread, no more and no less. Real bread, not manna. So where do we stand in today's gospel? With the crowd or with the religious leaders? Are we hungry for real bread? Or are we content to keep managing manna? We must turn to Jesus as our daily bread. So how can we access Jesus as our daily bread? As individuals, through the regular exercise of our spiritual muscles, such as prayer, Bible study, family worship, honoring Jesus as part of our daily routine. As the body of Christ, through our covenant with each other, to show up for prayer, Bible study, and worship, to be the body of Christ doing mission in this place. Which will it be, manna or bread? Manna is still available every day, every week. It may not look like a miracle, but it is, because as you know, nearly every church around of every denomination finds a way to provide emergency food, such as the blessing box here. Such an effort done week after week with no end in sight is truly a modern miracle. But emergency food is just enough to keep a person coming back, whether you are the church person doing the serving or the client doing the receiving, wishing for more, hoping for a better way to deal with hunger. Emergency food, manna, is never enough to satisfy. You won't get manna from Jesus. Jesus distributed real bread and fish at the feeding of the 5,000. It was not imaginary. It was not wish fulfillment. It was tangible. It was real. It satisfied their stomachs. People connected with him, followed him after that event, looking for more bread. They thought he was their new Moses, providing manna. But Jesus goes further. He is more than Moses. He himself is the bread of life. He's not talking about some spiritual fog that is supposed to satisfy our bellies with a notion of loving Jesus. He's talking about tough love, the fulfillment of his mission to bring healing and life and liberation to the people so that all the people will have all the bread that they need. We may do the work of Moses, who could not give real bread. He could only manage the contingency food, manna. Such work that we do is a grace, a work of mercy. But works of mercy are done every day by people of many different faiths. We who are called Christians must take a different way. We must do the work of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Jesus, our Lord, was the one who came from God to offer real bread, life, to the whole world. This is real good news. When we come to Jesus for our daily bread, the Spirit he sent awakens us so that the commitment we made at our baptism and our confirmation becomes real. Our worship together becomes alive. Our Bible study is electric. Our fellowship sparkles with energy because life with Jesus has meaning and purpose in a world plagued with hunger and despair. Aren't we hungry? Let's not be filling the void with manna. Let's feast on Jesus instead. He offers real bread. Jesus' bread nourishes our spirit, so that we may live as he lived, healing the sick, raising the dead, proclaiming liberty to the bound and shalom to all who will listen. Jesus' bread nourishes our bodies so that we may die as he died, unafraid, satisfied that we have run the race well, witnessing to God's glory to the very end. Jesus' bread nourishes our hope so that we may share in his resurrection, confident that God keeps covenant with us and with our descendants, powered up to reproduce ourselves, to speak the gospel word with joy, to be with our Lord forever. Come to Jesus. Let's enjoy real bread. Amen. Time for our prayer time together, and we are a small group here today, but we are large in faith, and we are large in viewership, so we expect that all of us are bringing forward in our prayer together all those that we know of who have needs, all those concerns we have, and all those joys that we have. And expecting that, let's join together in this fashion. I will speak our prayers on behalf of this congregation, followed by a moment of silent prayer. At each interval, I will say, Spirit of God, move among us. And I invite you to respond, Come, Holy Spirit, come. So let us be in prayer. Lord, we worship you. You alone are worthy of our awe, our prostration before you, our bowing down before you. Only you. So we worship you. Spirit of God, move among us. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Lord, we praise you. All those competing voices that ask for us to praise them are nothing compared to you. You are the one who has created this world. You are the one that sustains us, your power holds us together, so we praise you. Spirit of God, move among us. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Lord, we confess to you. We confess that we are complicit in the wrongs of this world. We let things slide that ought to be addressed. We are eager to seek our own comfort and our own wealth at the expense of creation. Our pride gets in the way of doing what you would like for us to do. Spirit of God, move among us. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Lord, we petition you. We complain to you of the injustice and hurting in our world, and we ask you for your support and strength as we confront injustice, disease, and even death. We bring before you those whom we know who are enduring pain, who are putting up with the discomforts of disability. We bring before you those who are afraid. We bring before you the ups and downs of this pandemic. your Spirit to guide us through. Spirit of God, move among us. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Lord, we thank you. We offer to you our gratitude for who you are, the triune God, who made all that is, who sustains all that is, who breathes life in all that is, and we thank you that we are able here in this space and at home to share in communion with you here and now. Spirit of God, move among us. Come, Holy Spirit, come. We praise and thank you for the gift of life which you continue to give to us now and forever through your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. It is time to receive the offering, and we do this virtually. There are four ways to give. There's a link on your Facebook screen. There's an offering plate here in the sanctuary, and you can also find ways to give online at helpofjesus.org, and you can use the post office. So with gladness, let us return to God these offerings, the sacrifices of our lives, our labor, and our stewardship of the earth. And having given up the offering, we can say, Blessed are you, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Consecrate these offerings to be used for the glory of your name and in service to your kingdom. Amen. Spirit, keep your minds and hearts and bodies renewed and refreshed until we meet again.